Joe Matarese is walking in. Center of all this internet controversy. Talking about him yesterday. You can follow Joe Matarese at the Joe Matarese on Twitter. No longer private, right?
No.
Congratulations on that.
I've learned so much in the past couple weeks. I was just saying to Roland, I'm like, why was Jim Norton not the first guy that I just called?
Right.
Why did I just like think I could figure it out? We were just saying that. I said, you know, when you haven't been socially media fucked up the ass really before.
So this was your first fucking up the ass.
It really was. Like I was saying, like I never, I mean, I've had like your negatives, but this is like a whole nother level. When it's like, I'm going to fuck your wife and they have her name in there and you're like, all right.
I was kidding.
Cool. But it's really funny.
Right.
How after about, once it's 10 days in.
Yeah, and you're like, okay, I'll just ignore it and it'll go away. And it's like, oh, it's still active.
No, but it actually doesn't. It's like, you start to laugh. You're laughing while they're reading that they're going to fuck your whole family and the asshole. And
so at first,
go ahead.
At first, it's like disturbing. And then it becomes like, and then 10 days in, you're like, this is just my life now. This is kind of funny.
Yeah, well, you're almost mad at yourself that you ever, ever thought it was real. Like you're like, oh
right.
See that you're as a normal person, when someone says that, you think, oh, they're really gonna show up at my front lawn.
Right.
And they're gonna pop, I'm gonna be walking with my daughter and they're gonna have some an Uzi in their hand and they're gonna rape your kids. That's you think that.
Right.
And then you start, it's like a puzzle really. It's funny how it just starts popping together. You're like, oh wait a second.
They're not really going to rape my kids.
Oh, they have one follower. Oh, they're not real.
Yeah.
They have 900 of these accounts. Oh.
When you realize that it's kind of the beginning, middle, and end of it is when you're catching an online beating, and we've all caught them severely sometimes. It stinks, and the instinct as a comic is because you get heckled, you address it, and you confront it. That's the way we kind of do it. Guy yells, "You suck." I've been told I suck. That's a harsh heckle, but I see the guy's. So you have, there's a way to deal with it, but when it's all online, you feel like there's no way to deal with it because it's just, it's coming. It's like, it's almost like a smell in the air. It's like, it's there and it's there and it's there, and I can't.
Plus, like, even if you turn it off, like you say, all right, well, I just won't look at Twitter and it'll go away, but you're just sitting there, like, looking at your phone, knowing that there's stuff there.
Well, it's that. There's also like there was fun little lessons. That's what was hilarious. I was like, at the same time, I was on like a very special 80s sitcom, like one of those. Like I was like learning. I was like, oh, like this is good. It made me take Twitter off my phone. Okay,
now
I can't tweet while driving. You know, you're like
right.
All of a sudden, you're like, holy shit! I just had a conversation with a person. This is crazy. You just were slowly.
It's improved. Improved your life.
I swear to God it has, yeah.
That's amazing.
In a weird way, I'm like, fuck. Now I just, I'll be honest, I downloaded the Twitter app on the subway coming
yeah,
over
here. It's going to start again. Yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah, it's real. Yeah. Well, yeah. I don't even know where to go with this, but Jesus.
So because we know we were talking to Ant on the show yesterday, and we ended up talking about this because there's just all, you know, comedian drama always ends up as fodder. But so like you were doing the live podcast with Jim and Ant and Artie.
Right.
And then like you were getting goofed on for some of the things that happened on that, which is fine. But then I'm not 100% sure when it was like it went from like, oh, this is, it's kind of funny the way this turned out. Like, let's goof on it to let's attack him online. Like that. Like that's,
you feel like it morphed into like from
how did it morph into that thing, right, where it's like,
well, what really happens, and I just did a podcast about this a couple of weeks ago, which is just the word miscommunication. I think that was another learning experience going through this, whatever it is, 10-14 days since it really started escalating, is that people are all hearing information on the internet, and that you realize when it's happening to you, holy shit, how many times have I been wrong thinking shit about a famous person or a non-famous person right. that they're writing shit about?
Mm-hmm.
So there were so many miscommunications that I was like, I'm sitting here trying to do the pod, you know, posting the podcast with an explanation on it. Not enough people are getting that. That didn't work. Then someone steals the video out of a subscription feed. That's really how, that's where a lot of my anger came from. Okay. Like, I got a wife and kids, okay? Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to do things to make money. I mean, I don't know, like Anthony, like, was, yeah, it's funny. Like, he's like, yeah, just laugh it off. I'm like, you're making a lot of money. Like, I'm a guy that's busting his fucking ass. I'm proud of what I do. And, you know, I gotta support my family. I mean, that was another thing that they just kept coming at. You're the stay-at-home dad. I'm like, I wish I was. I'm not, really.
This is my job, the thing.
I have a job. Yeah. Like, I'm at a comedy club right now as you're saying this. Where's this? Stay-at-home dad would be easy. This is stay-at-home dad and running a business, which is what a comedian has to do.
Yeah.
So you take a video that I produced.
Mm-hmm.
My money produced. It wasn't free. They don't just film things for nothing.
Right.
It wasn't the club turning a camera on. If you watch the video that someone stole out of my subscription feed, because you know, everybody's like, put it up for free. That's another thing that gets confusing. And you guys are here on Sirius XM. That's so great that you don't have to think about that.
Right.
Here's your listeners. Do a show. Like, guys like me were like, do I charge for this? Is this free? What ends up being the best platform? So then I go, fuck it. Maybe it'll help me build subscribers,
mm-hmm.
which it did, but was hilarious. They were mostly, and even that night when we did the show, it's Jim's fans, right?
Yeah.
It's Anthony's fans. It's Artie Lang's fans. And there's about six Fixing Joe fans, right?
Right, right.
So,
which is fine though, because that's how you build a new audience, right? That's how you grow the audience. But if it's just a whole bunch of Fixing Joe fans, you're just kind of preaching to the choir,
right? But what I should have done is made it free right away, and then, you know, you're not going to get these miscommunications, maybe. So people were like, that was the first miscommunication. This guy's trying to make money off of Jim Norton and Artie Lang and Anthony Cumia's names. He's making money. Like, I'm like, where's the? I'm like, what do you mean making money? I'm putting a podcast
mm-hmm.
in my subscription feed. That's where I put them. This is where they go. If you want to listen or you want to watch the video,
do you charge for all your podcasts, or you were just
I have free ones. They're never video though. The free ones. This was a video. I paid. You know, I paid. I had a band there.
Yeah.
That they don't show up and turn their instruments on for nothing. You know, it wasn't a crazy budget, but I was like, my main thing was, this.
You don't want to lose money doing it. Like, even if you just break even, it's not like you're looking to get rich off it, but you don't want to lose money doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's another thing for being in the business a long time, which also really helped going through this situation. If I was 3 years in and you're getting shit talked, you think you're out of the business. You actually think that. Like, holy shit. Did you ever have shit like that when you were starting? If someone said something negative, you thought you were never going to get worked at that club again?
I'm still convinced that I'm finished this year. Yes. We never get over it. Never. I never will feel like I'm made.
Right.
I remember when I was at open mics, a headliner called me at my parents' house. I'm like 19 years old, threatening to kick the shit out of me because I was doing his Tough Skins bit. I still remember it. I'm like, dude, you know, when you're starting out.
Is he still working or you don't remember?
No, I don't think so. I don't even think he's a comedian anymore. And I'm like, dude, like, I'm thinking in my head, when you're starting out as a comedian, you see, this is what I did, which was wrong, and it took me like 3 years to figure it out. I would see comedians doing bits about things, and I was like, oh, they're talking about NyQuil. I should do some NyQuil jokes. Like, oh, that they're doing commercial jokes? I should talk about commercials.
Because you're seeing it's working. Just their joke is working, so you take what the joke is about and just be like, well, that should work
for me. That subject should work for me, yeah.
Well, yeah, not the same joke. You're just like, the idea of talking about a commercial or a product, right? So I'm like, Tough Skins. I'm seeing a lot of guys are talking about these Tough Skins jeans that we had as stupid kids, you know? So then I'm talking about that, and this guy calls me at my parents' house, scared the it was like a version of this.
Yeah.
But way worse, because he's calling me on the phone, hey, this is so-and-so, and he's like a headliner. You're like, oh my God, he's a headliner.
Right.
He's like, you do that bit one more time. He didn't even threat, like, you're out of the business. He threatened, I'm going to kick the shit out of you.
And you were like, I could get my ass kicked and be out of the business.
I was not, I've never been ballsy, like where I'm like, you know, guys, I was always tough as shit on stage or in an angry situation.
Uh-huh.
But like 5 minutes afterwards, I was never like, I'm going to kick the, like it would just die really fast. And I'd be like, what do I do? What did I do? I'm going to get my ass kicked. Why was I so mad?
So like, so it's behind, so you put the video behind the paywall and that's the first miscommunication.
Well, I was thinking, yeah, that they were going to, it was going to increase subscribers. That's what I thought. Okay. This will make my family, we're going to make more money. This is going to do something for the, you know, the subscribers. So what happens is...
How much did you charge for it?
It's $2.99 a month to be a subscriber to my podcast. And then I give them so much stuff that they end up making money.
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, what happens is they come over, they can watch the... This is how dumb I am. I'm not thinking in advance. You almost have to be like pool players, someone who's good at chess or pool.
Yeah.
They're lining up the next five things.
It's not checkers.
I'm just going, put it in there. I'm not thinking someone's coming in, making a copy, putting it on YouTube, and then people are just going to start accusing me of 9,000 things.
I retweeted. I didn't know it was a stolen from the feed. I just saw a good version of it. I'm like, oh, this is a great, this was nice and crystal clear.
Perfect.
Because I'd seen a scratchy one. I was like, this is great. This looks good.
Yeah. Poor Jim. I talked to him the next day because I saw like Jim tweeted out a link like, oh, this is a good version of the podcast we did.
Right.
And like then I saw like all these people were like, oh, Jim's going to war with Joe Matarese, blah, blah, blah. And Jim came in the next day. I told him that morning. I'm like, oh, man, you said that tweet out. Was that a shot? And Jim's like, what? What? No, I just saw a good version of the video. I wanted people to see it. I don't even know what's going on.
Well, this is how crazy you are too, Jim. This is how nuts you start to get. Like, it was, this past week was very similar to the final scene of Sopranos, where he's just looking around thinking, there were times where I'm like, is that guy somebody? Like, is he coming over here to say some shit to me?
Right. Like, somebody's giving you a compliment, like, hey, I saw you at the show this last week. And you're like, wait a minute. Is he one of them?
Is he one of those?
Yeah.
Is he one of them?
Yeah.
here's what you learned very quickly. It probably never will happen. Nobody will ever, ever physically approach you because it's part of it is too. Part of the fun for them is like it is fun just to fuck around. Like there's a part of it where they're being dicks, and then there's a part of it where like it is just entertaining to like, you know what I mean? Like where they're just throwing a beating at somebody, and then the high is not what the right and wrong is because who gives a shit? It's just fun to be bashing this thing.
Right.
Like we would go after other radio shows years ago. Yeah, you know, like we knew that they were probably good guys and had some funny shit to say, but it was just fun to attack. You know, and then you move on, and that's but the fun is in the attack. So you learn that no matter what explanation you give, you know, you ever see Full Metal Jacket? No matter what answer he gives, if he reverses himself, the instructor would beat him harder, sir. Any answer is the wrong answer, sir. When you're in the middle of catching a fucking online dick kicking, it's fun for them to give you a good dick kicking, and especially if there's like a nugget in the middle that they feel is the truth.
Right.
But if you're inexperienced, your instinct is to be like, okay, hey guys, just wanted to get out there and say, I think there's been a misunderstanding. And then they're like, fuck you. And it's even harder.
Most of them, if you met them, literally, and I've had it happen with like, yeah, I was, they're just regular dudes just fucking talking shit.
I've literally had people come up to me at like, whatever, at your comedy shows or whatever, like, you know, when I'm just hanging out and been like, hey, Sam, man, I love what you do on the radio. I keep tweeting you trying to get you to block me, but you won't do it. And I'm like, oh, so that's all it is. Like, it's just some guy who's talking shit.
Yes.
Just because it's fun.
It's fun. You got to remember. And when you were that age, like, when you hit a certain age, that, you know, like my brother, it's like, he's 9 years younger than me, but he's still, I mean, he's a 40-year-old guy.
Mm-hmm.
When I tell him a story like this, he's just like, who the fuck has time for that? And I'm like, when you're young, you have time for this.
Yeah.
You really, it's like, this becomes your hobby, I guess. It's hilarious.
And then it's like putting on a show. Like, it's like, it stems from like our show or Ant's show or whatever the show is. And they get to kind of extend that show for themselves and become a part of it 24 hours a day. Like, they're just like, oh, I laughed so hard when we were talking about this on the air. What if I just fuck with this guy online? Right. All day.
You almost wish that they knew how comedians thought, because you're like, dude, I wouldn't mind you having a really good one and me laughing. I'll laugh. You know, I mean, you guys were burying me at they were so funny. Like, there's a moment there where I do go the other way, and that's what a lot of the feedback that negative on me was also. Like, mm-hmm. why is he getting serious? That was another miscommunication. Why I was getting serious was, not only was it a paid production, which I didn't tell Jim, and I didn't tell Artie, I didn't tell Anthony, I'm doing some sort of pilot here. I want to try to make a sizzle reel. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I have to do this 4 times with different guests, if I have to go do it in a studio with no audience. I should have told you guys, I'm experimenting. Because it just looked like, why the fuck does he have cue cards? Why the fuck?
It was fun to tease, though. Like, part of it, sometimes, sometimes the fun part of it is, like, watching the process and the machine breaks down.
It's
and
hilarious.
Watching the machine break down is funny.
I mean, it's literally what I was talking about yesterday. Like, I was laughing. I wasn't even there. And I was laughing just at the concept of, it's funny, the idea that you had this idea.
It's hilarious.
Wasn't communicated, but you had this idea in your head of how well this thing was going to go. And then, like you said, the machine totally breaks down and, like, everything's trying to be put back together, but it's a misstep and a misstep. And then from a guy who's on the outside, it's just fucking hilarious.
But also don't forget, we're bashing each other, too. Like, the first thing I do is make fun of Anthony being a pedo. Anthony makes fun of his fucking... I made fun of the fact that Anthony got fired for his Twitter rant. Made fun of Artie for being a drug addict. We're all in. We're so deep in fucking our problems being known that it's just I guess we don't realize that we're getting shit on in front of everybody is kind of like a little jarring at times because we just attack each other constantly. Nonstop.
The other thing I don't think people realize because they're I guess I'm like this introspective guy. That's my thing. I'll try to figure it. I'm trying to figure it out in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think people realize, and I'm guessing Jim would agree with me on this, and I think you would too, is that opposites make things funny. Like, people kept tweeting, these three guys, this, if that was just Norton and Anthony and Artie, and they were on the radio every day, man, that's fucking unbelievable. Greatest show ever. And I'm like, you guys don't understand that, like, if that show doesn't have me failing at something he's really trying to make work,
right?
And on top of it, I'm married with kids. They're all single guys that are just, doing the opposite that a married guy does. They're killing it in their careers. They're having fun. They're partying. It's like, maybe Artie's not having fun, but
yeah. And none of us are killing it in our careers. Believe me, Artie, and Anthony. You know what that is? That's 6 fingers barely holding on.
but don't you think? Like, I always think of, like, some of my favorite sitcoms.
Yeah,
every one of them has opposites jammed together. Right.
Right.
All in the Family has Archie Bunker with fucking, his son-in-law, who's the complete opposite of Archie. That show, Archie's not funny if he's just out loud talking to nobody that way.
But it's got to suck as a comic for you, who's there on your show,
right?
And your role is to be the in-the-barrel guy for this episode. Especially, like you said, and that's why it's hilarious, because you put all this money into a thing, you want to do a sizzle reel, and then the whole thing ends up with, well, now I'm just the in-the-barrel guy. This sucks.
Well, it helps sometimes to realize, too, what's happening in the moment. Like, because Joe wasn't necessarily in the barrel. Like, you were guiding it, but, like, you said, I called my wife a cunt, and, like, we went off on that. But it was a very funny, like that was this little thing you threw up there and became this giant topic. Like, it worked. So it wasn't like it was like you were sitting there doing something and everybody was like, bah, 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 shitting on you. Like, it didn't even occur to me. Like, I looked at you as just a part of the process. Like, you were one of us. I didn't look at it like you were separate until it looked like you got uncomfortable at one point. I thought you got uncomfortable at one point. Mm-hmm. But I didn't think, oh, man, we're killing Joe. I felt like this is his thing and we're all having a good... Like, I really saw you as part of it. I didn't see you as, like... Even the setup guy. I you were the guy who structured it, but I didn't see you as a guy that was just there for us to shit on.
Right.
Right, right. Well, that's because, we know each other, too, so, I mean, that
would be
ridiculous.
But did you get uncomfortable at one point?
I think, I think what happened was, in the middle there where you see me get mad, there was a time in my career where, like, I think certain shows that when you do them more than one time. Like, Jesus.
Oh, boy.
Oh,
they're
Joe.
Really going to kill you for
oh,
this one.
No.
Oh, Mr. Professional.
Oh, they got my
no.
home.
Oh, no. Joe, it's for you. It's Reddit.
Oh, what do you mean you call me a cunt? No.
Doxed.
So let's think if I can bring myself back on track here. So
I was asking if there was any moment that you felt, because Jim said that he caught that moment where you seemed uncomfortable. And I was asking, did you feel uncomfortable?
Well, yeah. So I was going to say something like when you do like a show, like for instance, like I was on Chelsea Lately a whole bunch of times, mm-hmm. right? But when you get, and like even, I don't want to sound like I'm hitting my credits up, but when you do shows more than once,
yeah.
you learn things.
Sure.
So like, for instance, what I would learn when I would do Chelsea was, oh, wait a second. I can actually say that joke sucked. Or,
yep.
Hey, I got another line. Like, because everybody was trying to cut each other's punchlines. If you ever watch these, you know, roundtable shows,
right?
Everybody's like, there's no, like, I guess people at home think there's a guy pointing at each guy and telling them when to talk. No, we are animals. We're trying to get jokes in. So I realized back then, it's funny when I voice, that didn't work, or why'd you cut me off? Why? What do you got? You got to keep talking, you know, like that kind of stuff.
Right.
So, in my head, which was a mistake.
I love the mistakes, though.
Mistakes are hilarious.
Mistakes are always funny.
Well, as a comedian, you get so insecure when you're not talking. So I was like, okay, either I'm quiet, because within 10 minutes, even faster than 10 minutes. I'm going, why did I bring all three of these guys out there at the same time? If you notice, I'm fine with just Anthony, right? Because I just brought him out and one guy can shit on you, but at least it's a conversation.
Right.
Right?
Right.
But when three guys are out there, there's a moment, if you watch this, you're going to watch it, and you better watch the paid version. I even put the podcast version out last night before I went to sleep. I was like, I got to get just the audio.
You probably
free
should
podcast,
put the audio out for free.
I did. Yeah.
Yeah, because so many people
are
talking about it.
I've been tweeting it, and you guys can retweet it.
We will.
So basically, I just wanted to... Jeez, my ADD is bad in the morning. Fuck, you're a good reeler in. Reel me.
Well, Jesus. you were talking about...
You wanted to... mine is bad, too, so I'll hear.
Does he have it, too?
No. Yeah, it's hard, dude.
You were talking about being uncomfortable.
Oh, so I realized within seconds, I'm like, these guys, what did I bring them all out at
right.
the same time, right? They're a grand slam hitter. This is like, you're bringing three guys. Not only are they naturally good at this...
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jim would agree with this. If you're naturally good at slamming people, right, and then you give them morning radio or afternoon radio for years,
right,
they're just tuning the shit out of that muscle.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, you talk about learning every time you do a show. If you're doing a show every single day.
Yeah,
right. That environment, because Artie survived in the same, not survived, he thrived in it at Howard. They're the same as Opie and Anthony fans. They're very, very hardcore. They don't, you know, they're fucking brutal.
Right.
And then me and Ant just had a comfort level because of all those years.
15 years of doing radio together.
You really, it's a weird sixth sense with another person you develop. Like, you understand their, whatever. It's just I can't describe it, but you know what I'm saying. It's just a comfort with somebody and the way they improv and the way they move and the way they talk.
Right. And the Opie and Anthony show that you did for so many years thrived on you, Robert Kelly, Bill Burr, Patrice O'Neill, all at the same time. If you can survive in that, you have an unbelievable skill. You know when to score your points. You know when to listen. Now,
and so you're looking at this group of guys going like, these are the three guys that I brought on, and now I have to try to get in edgewise somewhere on my own show.
And I'm bad at it to begin with.
Right.
I'm not a talk to three guys ever. Mm-hmm. Like, when I would go into that Comedy Cellar table and they would go into attack mode, I don't know if ADD connects to this, because I take Adderall. I took it an hour ago, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When they're going...
Hope it kicks in soon.
I think I need double. I really... It could be the wrong drug for me. I really think it at times.
Yeah.
Because all I'm doing is talking fast, but that doesn't mean I'm listening. You know? You need
true.
To be doing both.
Yeah.
And when those guys are scoring points, I can't get a point in is like... And I'm like, I don't have that mind. But what I do have is, let me tell you how you hurt my feelings right now. Like, that's all I got.
Yeah, I can tell you what my feeling, what's inside right now. Yeah. I'm just going to let that out.
You're all
that,
laughing, but there's a sad boy in there.
Yeah, there really is. And I might as well have stood up out of my chair and called you guys on being single and you can't get get somebody to stay in a relationship with you. I got so many tweets about that. They're like, why would you say that to those guys?
They're just sitting there being funny on your podcast and you're like, fuck you guys.
I'm like, fuck you guys. You tried to commit suicide and I have a wife and kids. And they were like, what an asshole.
Exactly. Me and Artie are like, yes, we did try to commit suicide. And Anthony's like, I try it every morning. Drinking until 6 in the morning. I love Anthony.
So you catch shit from that. You catch shit from the paywall. Uh-huh. And then at what point does it become this kind of monster that you can't really control anymore in terms of the negative feedback? Like, before we're here, like, it gets to this place where you have to privatize Twitter and just be like, what the fuck is going on?
Right. Well, it's as soon as you got mad at one thing. One interaction back that sounds like...
I see.
And then they're like, we got him. And when I read someone write, we got him on the hook, that locked in my brain. I'm like, I see the game now.
Yeah.
Oh, they got me on the hook. It was like they just went click. You know when you catch a fish, that feeling? You're like, ah! And they were just like, we got him. And then I went the other way in my head. I'm like, no, you actually just lost me by saying that.
Because I figured out the...
Yeah, this is a game. Now once you realize it's a game, it's funny. And
right.
It's funny, and it doesn't hurt anymore.
Uh-huh.
No matter what you do, it doesn't really hurt. Like I said, yeah. And then it's just, okay, how long do you want to... You want to just keep talking about this forever? I'm like, I'm really not going to engage with you. Really.
Right.
But the only confusing part is, and you guys can give me advice, I mean, do you just let it all go, or do you block anybody in the situation?
Yeah, I'll block people on Twitter. There's times where people, if they're dicks, I talk to people in DM once in a while, because when you're in a public thing and you're yelling at each other, it's like then you both want to win the argument. People are much more reasonable in DM, and sometimes I literally have a question as to something, but once in a while I'll still block somebody, not as much as I used to.
I think it's tough though, and I wouldn't do any. You can mute people because they never know if they're muted.
But don't block.
Yeah, I muted people too.
If there's an organized... Because if there's a group of people that are like, let's fuck with Joe, right?
Uh-huh.
Then the minute you block somebody, they're going to figure out what made you block them, and they're going to go, hey, guys,
let's do more.
This is what made... This is what really got him. He blocked me.
Yeah. But if you block a lot of people, if you just block, you'll get a lot of people because they get tired of making new accounts. But it, after a while, it does run out of a little bit of steam. But it's like, it's just too much to block all those people.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why I honestly think, like, it takes so much less energy to just ignore it.
Well, this might be funny for you guys for the air. Well, no, I shouldn't do it because then they'll just do it so much.
Well, but
I was starting to enjoy it.
Yeah, let me hear.
Let's go to Joe's Twitter feed.
Well, it's not even the Twitter feed. It's even funnier because I have a Google voicemail for my podcast.
Oh, no.
So I will post a topic usually, what my discussion point's going to be.
Sure.
And I'll let them leave messages either asking questions or giving me advice on it.
Right.
For the every podcast. And they found that number, which it's there. It's on my website. So they find the number.
Right.
And then they just start calling, right? And you know what? Once they... here's another thing that's a good note
you
for us.
You could do your own podcast at this point just about... Who's trolling me this week?
You should do a couple now that once you've said it, but like before you said it, you have all these recordings. You should do a couple of podcasts on it.
Just on the record. But then you'll get 6,000.
You will, but then you don't do it after that. Like, if you already do it with what you have,
because
then people will call just to get on the podcast and be... Right. Sometimes people are nasty just so you respond to them.
Right.
Yeah.
See, some people don't realize, like, when you get blocked is when you're nasty without a punchline, or if you're nasty and your punchline's not good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the ones that are funny and the ones that there's only, like, I swear to God, this is the sad, which I was going to say, I wish they were more clever, is that they're all doing the same joke. It's like watching the same joke. I'm like, dude, faggot is old at this point.
Like, in my life, it is.
Yeah. Old and accurate.
It's like, absolutely, it's in a mirror image.
It's like faggot and fucking my wife is so fucking my daughter. It's all been, no matter how, where, how amazing is it that fucking my daughter is hacky now? Like it's been done.
Yeah, that's gotten, to you, that's you've funny. Heard it so much. It's like, I'm kind of cold to that. It doesn't do anything to me anymore.
But like, there's
kind of incredible.
There's certain ones that were funny, you know?
But I like, if you do it right, you will come out of this, hopefully, with a much thicker skin.
Right. My skin is, it's like I said, I'm not lying. Like, that's what I tried to say on the audio podcast version at the beginning before you hear the interview. I'm really not lying here. Like, it's funny. Like, I'm okay. I go, I'm not a good liar. I don't think comedians, you got to be, maybe hacky comedians are good liars. Good comedians are good comedians because they're so good at being honest about themselves.
Right.
I'm telling you, things that could get me 9 million shitheads calling on a voicemail.
Right.
But, you know, I got to tell, once they became audio, they weren't as funny though. The ones in the words that are good ones is like, it's like reading a good joke, like a good roast joke is funny on the paper.
Right.
You're like, that's fucking brilliant. That's a great joke.
But you hear the voice or you hear a stutter or a stammer or whatever, and you're like, ugh, this is what was bothering me.
You can hear how dumb somebody is. Mm-hmm. Like that they're like 17 and they're uneducated and they have no cleverness in them and they're just saying they're going to fuck your wife without a punchline. I'm like, not.
Did somebody say that on your voicemail?
Yeah, probably. There's okay. I'll tell you the funniest one out of all the guys. This one made me laugh because I made the mistake of using some stupid Italian thing to get angry. Because even when I used to have my anger problem, when I used to slam hecklers, like I have an album that's just me yelling at hecklers. Okay. The whole album is arguments.
So you're used to being combative.
I used to be so combative before meds. They really, I'm telling you, they changed my life. I don't, like I said, but the anger's in your brain, but it's in a headlock now. That's what it is. But for 10 minutes when I first had it happen, it slid through the fucking, it's like a, you know what I mean? Uh-huh. If a goalie had a full, like, you know, board in front of the goal, but had a little hole, like it was sliding out the hole.
I gotcha.
So I sent some. I thought I was being funny, but I said.
But as it turns out, do you think you maybe not?
The crowd did not interpret that.
No. I don't mean the. Well, you tell me because this is what I said.
Okay.
And back to a person. Mm-hmm. My first one was I wrote why? ? Just why? I was like, I don't understand why.
What did
like,
they say?
When at the beginning of it all, like why? And they were like, you know, that's what we do. You know, we rip on people. That's what we do. It's all good and fun. Okay. Like, it was not cool. It's just not cool. Uh-huh. I said something like not cool, and I said,
"Oh boy,
this was hilarious. This is where they just started jumping because now a lot of
you should have wrote, hey guys, don't say this stuff. It hurts my feelings.
Yeah, exactly. Can we all be cool for a sec, guys? Like,
hey, remember in high school, lay off, man. That said lay off, you were getting your ass kicked. Yeah.
I know I'm the teacher, but I'm like the cool teacher. Okay, yeah. So we can just."
So, oh God. So I went with some sort of like Italian thing that I put up there. Let me think what it was. It was something like, I said, did you see the movie Goodfellas? Do you remember what they did to the guy who wouldn't shut the fuck up?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was just trying to be, funny.
You're talking about like Billy Batts when they put him in the...
No, he's talking Pesci about with the ice pick in the neck.
And now he says it, right? As soon as he kills, it's a great part of the movie. He just goes, I thought he never shut the fuck up.
Right.
And he just slides it in like slowly.
You're not going to stab anybody with an ice pick.
No, but I was trying to be, that's how crazy, when I used to get heckled before antidepressants, I would go right to a fighting type thing and funny at the same time. Like, I did the Apollo once when I wasn't on medication.
Mm-hmm.
They introduced me. I'll never forget it. I think I was wearing like a rock t-shirt at the Apollo at like, there wasn't, not only was the whole audience African-American, black audience, everyone that worked on the show is black. So not only are you the only white person, you know, on stage and in the room where the show's going, every camera guy's black, every PA's black, every key grip's a black guy, and it's just you in your Led Zeppelin shirt.
Mm-hmm.
And some lady standing on the top of her chair is heckling me wearing a house coat with like gold teeth in her mouth, telling me to get the fuck off the stage.
Right.
And I went right to just complete anger, and it was killing with some of the crowd, which was like, I go, why are you booing me? I didn't move into your neighborhood. Like, me, racist funny was right. coming out. I go,
I like that.
I go, was it? Why are you booing me? I go, just because it's raining, because it was drizzling. I go, just because it's raining doesn't mean you sell crack. You can't sell crack today. Like, why are you here? Because I realized fast when I was there, you don't realize another thing when you're watching these shows like the Apollo on television, is that they filmed them in the middle of the afternoons on work days in Harlem on 125th Street. So, and it's free to get in. So it's not a sophisticated audience.
Right,
it's
like, right.
It's just people that are, they can't wait to try to stand on their chair and boo. It's
I like would have said to that lady, miss, these people are here to see me and be entertained, not hear you.
Oh, that's actually really
thanks, Sam.
Good.
That would have shut her right
way
down.
Way to handle it, dude.
Absolutely.
Way to handle it.
Yes.
Feckless Cunt on Twitter just tweeted the show account and just wrote the word why.
Why? With a question so many mark. Whys.
Well, Tef Chipperson raises why? A good point. He says, no one is on Twitter just to give people shit. Jim Norton's wrong. We are all loving and happy followers. But then hashtag cunt. spoils
so,
it.
So here is the funny one that I remembered because the Italian thing sets it up.
Yeah.
This guy wrote something like, dude, you're not 100% Italian. You don't live in Italy. So you might want to check that out. The only thing you are is 100% a faggot. Like that would made me laugh. I went, that's pretty funny. Like that might be the only one that that sticks.
I would say if you're getting heckled online, like mafia bravado is probably not the way to go.
Yeah, it's probably not the way.
Dude, it was the biggest mistake I've ever done. I got so many like, hey! just tweets that sounded like Guido's in North Jersey.
People didn't think you were connected?
No, not a second of... The funny thing, I do so many jokes in my act about being a non-Italian Italian, you know?
Yeah.
So I was like, what do you even... Where did that come from? How desperate you sounded.
They're saying, give this mobster the real the Nancy Grace treatment. They're not happy.
Mobster.
Italian opie is a real hoot. How much fun is it just to be shit on? It's up there with people that... It's up there for people who that like him. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, that's also... Like, I contacted Jim after this all went down. And this was something that you guys did back in the old radio days, Jim told me. Because another thing is I start to think of project ideas when things happen. Like that album of me yelling at hecklers came from getting fired at clubs because my anger was too much. And then I was like...
Well, let me use this thing.
I put one on YouTube. This was back when there weren't a lot of those heckler things on YouTube. There's one of me that has almost 4.4 million.
That's right, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was back, like it's 8 years old.
Yeah.
I remember it was getting so many hits back then. And now, like, you put a heckler video up, nobody gives a shit. It gets, like, 12 hits.
Yeah.
But instantly I went, I think there's something here. Let me make it. And I started listening to tapes. I'm like, dude, I'm losing my shit all the time on all my old stand-up tapes. I got an album worth of shit here.
Mm-hmm.
And then I put it together. So it was like when I saw how funny you guys were, when you had something weak to shit on, that's where I went to. I'm like, this old pilot idea where you guys had done it on O&A where you bring in old clips.
Sure.
But it disarms it if I bring it in and go, look how fucking bad I am here. Like, and you can't wait to tell your story behind the tape. I was like, I wanted to do a television show, especially now that there's all these streaming comedy networks, because I couldn't, when your fans, they could have watched 10 hours of you guys shitting on something. I think I can just imagine him, Ant, and Art. I mean, imagine them as the three people just shitting on videos.
Yeah.
But the person brought in the video, so they're okay. You're okay with it.
Did you have to, like, have a conversation with your wife when this started of being like, look, honey, I just want you to know I'm a little more stressed out right now than usual, and it might, you know, it's going to be like a while.
A lot of guys threatening to hit you with a wrench and fuck you just to ignore it.
And, you know, they're also saying they're going to rape our daughter, and it's a lot right now, so if you could just give me a little space, you know.
I know the garbage. I should have taken it out, but I didn't yet, but again, I'm fending off.
I'm a little bit on a hairline trigger because they keep threatening to assault you, so...
they superimposed our daughter on a on a rape doll. So
it's getting to be a bit much. Did you have to have a conversation like that,
dude? That's exact conversation a few days ago.
Just like, understand, I'm stressed out right now because this is what's happening.
Yeah, we were on our way to her, you know, to watch the playoff games.
Yeah,
and I said, I just want to let you know, like. And then she, like, my wife, every once in a while, she can suck. Like, that was a bad, I don't think she handled it right. And I went,
oh, really?
I went right back at her. I go, are you fucking serious right now?
I'm not taking this from you, because everywhere I go.
I go, have you heard of, what's the bad expression? Putting the shoe on the other foot.
How did she handle it wrong? She yelled at you, or she wanted to go back at them?
She was like, she goes, you know how much we've been talking about this week? I don't want to talk about this anymore. And I go, okay. That's not what I'm trying to talk about. I'm trying to give a disclaimer.
Right.
If there's a moment where I seem like I'm a little bit in my head thinking about some shit, because you naturally start thinking of ways to get back at people, or yeah. That's your brain starts going.
Yeah.
And my brain, as you could hear in the last 45 minutes to an hour that we're talking, I'm not always thinking of getting you back. I'm thinking, how do I make this a positive?
Yes.
How is this? Is this a movie? Is this a documentary? Is this my next special?
I don't necessarily see it as a movie yet, you know.
No, but like, I started thinking.
Yeah, the guy who gets trashed online in theaters Tuesday.
No, but dude, I'm psycho. I started thinking, what if the movie, like, it was like some crazy guy, maybe not a comedian, mm-hmm. and he's getting tortured on the internet, like he's some sort of creative guy, and he's medicated, and he's able to hear, you know, and then just one tweet comes in. And he goes, fuck it, I'm going off my meds. And he just slowly starts fucking losing his shit.
I feel like it depends. Like, if you can't, because right now, even though psychologically you seem like you're in a better place, you are still in the thick of it, I think. You know what I mean? It's a little.
I'm sure this is going to really slow it down.
You think so?
I don't know about that, Joe.
I'm kidding.
But if you can, like, get out of it, then once you get out of it, I feel like you could create the Joe Matarese guide to getting trolled and surviving or something like that.
Well, here's the thing, which I don't...
But you have to survive it first, right now.
I don't know if trollers realize this. And you tell me if I'm wrong on this, okay. But I don't have to survive, because I almost think, like, it isn't anything. Like, what is it but attention?
It is, but it is a psychological attack but in the sense that, hurt? Like, yeah. You're literally... in a car, like, these are anonymous people, right? They're uh-huh. just fans, they're just viewers, they don't even know you. And they've had such an impact on you that you're in a car
thinking
fighting with your wife, not just thinking about it, you and your wife are now fighting with each other on a real level because of some guy on Twitter, right?
Yeah.
No,
it is still, like, that's the effect, I feel like, and that's where it's like,
were you cursing you. Around the house? Like, oh, just, oh, these fucking guys, and then she comes in.
Language, young man.
No, but I really did think, I love those moments. I've actually been trying to write a bit about this, where you have such a good comeback mm-hmm. on someone you're in a relationship with mm-hmm. that it's so good that you're proud of yourself for saying it, and she looks like she's going to divorce you. Like, that's how good it was.
But you're just happy with yourself.
But you're
because
like,
it's like, what a great line.
Like, you're like thinking of your friends that were there. If they were there, how proud of you they would be.
Well, the one that you can't get in because you know it would wreck everything.
Right.
Like, if she makes fun of your Dodgers hat and you want to say, yeah, but your pussy smells like garbage.
not as much probably like creativity with that one. It's almost a non sequitur.
Well, this is when I knew it was creeping into my brain in a bad way at the beginning. Yeah. When for a second... I started hearing Jim Norton's voice in my head going, you're not editing this, right? This is what he says to me after the taping. Mm-hmm. You're not going to edit this, right? Don't edit it. You got to put this out there. I mean, you can't edit it, right?
Yeah.
So then I'm going, is he part of this? Jim's in the sting. This is a sting.
Yeah.
No, I just didn't want you to. I thought it was really funny and natural. And it got, because I know when I saw under the cameras, you were doing something. I didn't want it to be an edited, like, perfectly segmented thing. Like, I thought we were all having a good time. I was more thinking about the way we were joking around. I didn't want any of that cut up.
I didn't edit one piece of that.
No, but, I know, I can tell.
But it was funny because he was like, you're not
Yeah, you watched it for free, right?
I did, yeah. but no, my motive wasn't that I thought you were going to look bad. My motive was I was literally worried if it only got put out in, say, a 10-minute hunk,
right,
that there was a lot of funny stuff that we were saying. I didn't want, because I hate when I see something that we did or whatever, and you see it chopped up. You're like, fuck, why'd they take that joke out? That was a... Could you, like, sure. That was more, I was more worried about.
Especially because people on YouTube now will watch an hour-long video.
They will, yeah. But that's all I was thinking, not for any...
Oh, I know that. I know that. But that's how crazy, like, the brain starts to go at first, that it can go to these, like, weird spots.
Yeah.
And
now that you just said that, by the way, you're going to get 100 tweets going, according to Jim, we should say it. And they're all going to be blaming me.
Yeah.
Or like they insult you and just write, see at Jim Norton or see? At Jim Norton.
Jim, how's that? I said.
Well, to
soldiers of Norton.
Well, to give major props to Jim, I mean, if you guys haven't watched this video yet, like, this is how funny Jim is in it. And I mean, why wouldn't he go, you better not edit that and please put this out there. I'm literally watching it going, this guy might, this video, this is saying something, might be, you're watching somebody do shitting on something and people better than anyone that's ever done it. Like, that's how good it is. I mean, it's like on a Don, like if you can watch some of those old Don Rickles things where Don, there's a couple of them on YouTube, but Don Rickles roasting like every celebrity in Hollywood and they're all in the audience and he's not blinking and he's just shitting on them all and it's so good.
So you're sitting there like watching Jim going, this is... He is the best at what he's doing right now, and God damn it, why won't he follow my format?
No. But literally, when I watched it back, I'm like, because you notice things more when you watch it versus hosting. I'm going, this is how good Jim is. He's making Artie look kind of not as he's like everybody was always Artie was the guy that you thought, wow, he's so quick, he's so good at. Like that. He's got like six jokes. Like,
right.
Jim's so good at it in this video, Jim, that you can see it in your... I love watching his eyes when he's getting where he saw your mistake.
And they start darting.
It's like watching like an expert like military guy. You're like, he's like, he's got four things on you right now.
He does this thing where like somebody says something and he just starts to smile a little bit, and he'll always let them finish their sentence. And I'm like, oh, no. Like, they just keep going, and they don't realize they're already in the grave.
How many people... I feel bad for my neighbor's band. They really got shit on a lot.
Oh,
my God. That's my neighbor.
They didn't get praised?
Oh, no. I gotta agree, like, on the recording, listen to the podcast version, the audio.
Yeah.
He doesn't sound good.
He doesn't.
He sounds bad. I'm like...
See, that's my favorite thing, and that's why, like, I would... You almost like... So there's two reasons to watch this thing for me now. Number one, when I first heard about it...
The bear.
When I first heard about it, I was like, oh, I want to watch this just because I keep hearing how good... It was just watching Aunt Jim and Artie go back and forth and just fire shit out like that. Like, that's just fun to watch. But then when it became this other thing, like, there's so many levels of people going, I really thought this was going to go better. Like, it's you being like, this was supposed to be my fucking sizzle. What's going on?
There wasn't a second of sizzle. You know how bad something has to go that you can't pull 30 seconds out of it?
It's the band, especially now that I know the band is like your neighbor and your buddy, and the band being like, oh, this is actually, I know these comedians. Like, this is going to be a big break for us. And like, they're just looking at these comments going, like, Joey, everybody said we suck. Like, what did you do to us?
I think this guy's like so not on social media. That's what's even funnier. Like, since we've done this together, like, he talks to me so much now. Like, all I have to do is like catch his eye on the corner.
Oh, yeah.
When I'm putting my trash out, and he's like, hey, that was a good time. That was the greatest time. And I'm like, oh, please don't. Please don't go on Twitter. Jesus Christ.
Oh, you're like fixing... Oh, is that your thing or they make that?
So, that's an old one. That's a read. That's actually a fan who originally made that.
MJ.
A long time ago.
MJ's a strange one. He has the weirdest little Twitter avatar photo.
Yeah.
I don't know who that is. It's like a kid leaning down by a bowl or something. He's some funny shit, though. Dude, you have no idea how much money I've made subscribing to the Joe Matarese podcast.
Somebody, I went. Somebody,
how much money I made?
Somebody just called you a fake mobster.
Yeah. Oh,
that'd
yeah.
Be, that'd be MJ.
That's a good one that they got the papers. That's like, the guy who grabs the collar.
MJ again, going skin so thin it melts right into the sauce.
Oh, someone said that. Yeah.
That was a funny one.
I remember that one. At liquefying the pan.
At,
yeah.
Look at. Oh, I love Army Brat Ray Ray.
Who's that guy? What movie's that from? With the hand?
I don't know.
It's just a guy that's doing hilarious. The Italian, like, hey, yo, whoa, whoa, hey.
I'm so bad at being Italian that I think I just created a genre that didn't exist, which is the guy who's trying to be Italian that's just bad at it. You can't even, you're like, get the fuck out of here.
He wrote in Italian, he wrote, why do you hate blacks and Italians?
Translated from Italian.
Oh my god!
The best part is like we're doing another one of these Valentine's Day, but it's not no cameras, no pilot.
You're not gonna film this one.
You should film it, even if it's not the same quality.
I think the club has just a low quality.
It's
thing
not
that
a good quality
get,
though.
Right.
But you should do it, dude. It's there's something there. It's a funny format.
Well, it's me, Florentine, and Paul Verzi doing a mashup. We're all doing our podcasts at the same time on stage.
Okay.
And it's on Valentine's Day, so I'm like, we have to be drunk and sing love songs for no reason at some point.
Like I would watch a show. If you invited like three comedians, like, I mean, and Florentine is right in that club, but right. Those just quick comedians that are just Rob, on there
that's what,
to shit on people. But if it was just like, if I could watch every month you
fail,
trying to do a show and fail, I would probably subscribe to that because I would want to see that.
That's what my Justin McKinney, comic friend of mine, said. This is like, he's like, it's bad, but it's entertaining. He said,
right.
I'm entertained. So he goes, try it again, because we know so many guys that are good at this. It's all those guys.
But you have to go in with a genuine game plan every time and really get mad if it's not going right.
How do you really get mad if it's not going right unless you took like a couple of $1,000 and I invested it in on something that was a waste of time?
That's what you got to do.
How do I do that?
You got to waste your time every time and then try to make it something else.
Or you switch what the goal of it is. Like sometimes... You know, there's an old expression. I came up with this. Lennon stole it. But life's what happens when we're making other plans. Well, that's what the podcast kind of was. Like you had like a bit of a structure, but it turned into another thing. But it still wound up being entertaining. Like sometimes you don't realize what it is you're going to wind up with. It just goes into another direction, but it's still something decent.
Right.
So you could still you don't be as rigorous. What do they say? Wear life like a loose fitting sweater.
Like,
you don't be as rigorous in what it has to be.
Right.
Because it could turn into something else.
It could turn into something else, yeah. It could morph into something else.
Well, it's like when you see a shitty movie, but somehow it takes a new life on when you're watching it, that it's like funny for a different reason.
Right.
But I had a friend, I remember I'd taken him to see some movie years ago, and we leave, and he was like, that sucked. And I go, dude, you laughed more than I've ever seen you laugh. Like, you must have had 50 out loud laughs in that movie. That's a win. I don't give a shit how you got there.
Right.
We just had a good time. Who fucking cares? That was awesome. You know what I mean?
There's
certain things that can do it. It's like, that's probably where Mystery Science Theater came from. It's like, here's something shitty, and we're going to tease it up a little bit.
Like, we're enjoying not liking this too much for it not to be a thing.
Yeah. Like, that was one thing I was thinking of doing with the video, but I guess I could recut it and do a whole other thing, was to, do like a commentary, make fun of it myself, and then go back to the video.
I cut
to Jim, and he's like, I don't know, man, we fucking, like, make a...
It would be funny doing a commentary where you just talk about all the mistakes that you made.
Just my mistakes.
Yeah,
like a director's cut where you discuss it.
Yeah. Like, oh, I shouldn't have done that.
But with these guys, what if we were like in a room and we were cutting back and forth? I think people would rewatch that.
Yeah.
Like with our commentary on it.
Yeah, I think
audio
so.
Or visual? Visual, I don't know.
Yeah, you'd have to.
Yeah, good luck getting Artie Lang, Anthony Cumia, and Jim Norton in a room to do a project.
Well,
it's not that hard.
Jim would show up.
Look how successful it was the first time.
And you know where Anthony is.
I couldn't believe they all showed up.
Yeah, of course. And you know where Anthony is every day. Ant's at the studio over on the 35th.
I'm doing his show today. So.
Yeah, you've been in it before. So, you know, and Artie come. Artie's got his podcast, so he would come.
Well, we'll.
Let's do it. Let's produce that.
I think that could be the next step.
It's a serious XM production.
You're back on a public Twitter, which has got to be great, at the Joe Matarese. No more private.
I guess I have to open up the YouTube videos because they were shitting on everyone in my whole
yeah,
library.
Yeah, they're going to do that.
Let them do that?
There's not much you can do about it. It's like, it's frustrating sometimes, but it's like, what are you going to do? I mean, you can't stop it.
Right.
I've gotten pissed off, but I've also, you know, there's some really funny dudes out there. I mean, in all honesty, there's some of them are fucking hilarious.
It's it's worth it you're saying it's worth it to hear the really funny ones, ignore all the unfunny means, and go to the funny.
Dude, you were screamed at the Apollo.
Yeah, that's what I said. Once you've been bombed at the Apollo, like, you can almost handle a lot of things, you know?
Well, you can see Joe's special Medicated on CISO. You can download Fixing Joe, the podcast, free episodes every Friday on iTunes, and the special weekly bonus episode available to subscribers.
Right.
connectpal.com/Joe Matarese.
Sorry, I interrupted.
No, it's your plug. You can interrupt all you want.
So, the podcast version I decided to put in the free feed last night before.
Smart, yeah.
And so you can listen to that. It's on iTunes. If you go to joematarese.com, you can listen to it without iTunes, you know. And
and you can go to joematarese.com for the info on the Valentine's Day show, right?
I guess I should plug where I'm going to be this Saturday.
That would be smart.
Not? Joe's a funny stand-up. People want to invest in, like, we're all angry at Joe, but we're not.
Right.
Like, I like Joe. Yeah. Joe's my friend.
Right.
For a long time.
You probably wouldn't have done his show if he wasn't your friend.
If I was the worst comedian, you know? Would those three guys be, if I was, like, the biggest hack douche ever.
Right.
Like some of these guys are saying, would those guys, would I have opened for one, Bill Burr in front of 14,000 people, would he go, I got to get that terrible guy to go in front of me?
Well, obviously.
Just like, yeah. It never works. Why do I try to give myself a compliment? I should have punched myself in the face right there.
But where you be this Saturday?
This Saturday, I'm doing this Miserable Dads Tour show with Shuley from Howard Stern and Scranton at the Leopard Theater. So go to joematarese.com if you want to buy tickets to that.
How many kids does Shuley have?
Two.
I love Shuley. He's a funny stand-up.
He's a good guy, too.
I worked with him a lot. He's a really funny stand-up.
Yeah.
We're trying to add Florentine and do this Miserable Dads thing. It's perfect because he's the single dad. It's fucking hilarious.
Right, right.
He's like, yeah, I'll do it. I don't fucking care.
Yeah, why not?
Give a shit. Why wouldn't I do it? If I'm off, I'll be there. That was the only thing I think that went well for me on the live show, too. Was
the Florentine impression?
It might have been the best and funniest Florentine that I accidentally ad-libbed. When you just have one of those accidentals, and I watch it and I go, that's pretty funny what I'm saying about the tolls in Florentine.
Yeah, thank God I had that. I had that.
Well, there's certain things people have said to me where I go, that guy's funny. I don't care if he says 90 never funny things ever again. Mm-hmm. I remember that funny thing he did or that funny thing he said.
Well, I don't think anybody's going to remember any of the unfunny stuff.
Joe, we hate you. No,
there's nobody that remembers that. Thank you for coming in, Joe.
Yeah, come back and see us again, man, anytime you want.
Dude, I loved sharing that with you guys. And I think we're on to something.
Awesome.
Yeah.
We got a pilot.